Okay, so welcome to Idea From Idea to Book. And we're offering these, every semester, every couple of semesters, and Michael did one, I believe it was last in the summer, right? And so that to really give you a sense of process, since that's what we're working in here during your four semesters. And I think it's really useful for you to get a more detailed sort of inside look into the process that a writer's gone through in producing a book. And each book is really different, I'll tell you that. In my case, the process of writing each one of my books was different, and then my process, of course, would be very different from Michael's or from Bill's or Rachel's or any of your process. So that's why it's good to hear this kind of thing from more than one person and hear about more than one book. There's a lot that you can learn. So I'm going to be talking to you about Centerville, and I'm going to start off with kind of the conception. I'm going to talk about the actual writing of it, and I did some research, which I'll talk about too. And I'm also going to talk about, I did a little reflecting on this, I'm also going to talk about some of the obstacles that I ran up against and some of the difficulties that I had. And then I'll talk about the publication process, which was sort of interesting because I worked with a couple different editors on it as it ended up at very different houses. And then I'll talk for a while, and then I'll ask if there are any questions, and I'm happy to do a Q&A, or I'm happy to answer any questions that you have. So this is a book that started off quite differently than my other novels, and in that it's based on something that actually happened, even though it's very fictionalized. And so I tend to write about things that are completely different than what I experience in my own life. So that's how it was really different for me, and or a departure. And so I'll tell you what the incident was first, and then how I ended up writing about it. So the incident occurred when I was about 10 years old, and we had just moved to this, we had left this island that I had grown up on, and we had moved to this little town in Ohio. And, I tend to move. I'm a moving target. Over a little bit this way.
you can move, just move toward the banner and back.
Okay. If I can remember that. It's like totally unconscious when I start doing. All right, so we had just moved to this little town in Ohio, and I had this girl that I became friends with quickly, and her father was, as it turned out, was a pharmacist in this little drugstore. And so that's where everybody would go, like if you were a kid that age. You go, and her father, we'd get free sodas if we went there, which was at the soda fountain, which was this big deal. And so this was in the late 1960s, 69. So anyway, what ended up happening was it was a really hot day in the summer, and we were going down there. We walked downtown, and we walked up to the door of the drugstore, and similar to the Sandy in my novel, this is there are a couple things in there that are based on my memory, and that's one of them. I put my hand on this door and backed away from it. And I had no clue why I had done that, but I just knew I wasn't going in that store. And so, and she was kind of mad at me because I wasn't going in the store. And instead we went down the street to this bowling alley where a bunch of kids were hanging out, including our brothers and some other friends. And so he's going to kill me by the end of this. About 5 minutes after walking in there, maybe 10 minutes, there was this big boom that sounded like thunder, and we walked out, and the drugstore was a 5-story building, and it was completely in flames. And both her father and her brother was in there too. So she and her brother both went running into these flames. And the flames just really quickly engulfed the couple of buildings that were next to it. So it was this enormous fire. And the town did not have the resources to put it out right away. And so it spread and spread very quickly. And there was a paint store near it, and it hit a paint store, and that exploded. And so it was this enormous fire that lasted the rest of the day. It started, right around lunchtime, and it went into the dark. And so just as a kid, I was just running through this fire. I mean, I was in this, running through the fire trying to find her. And there weren't any, it was just kind of chaos. So there wasn't, and my mother didn't know. My mother knew that I was down. She thought I was in the drugstore. My brother was. But anyway, my parents didn't find us for a long time until, I think, in the evening. So it was this long day. And so this happened. And it's not like as a kid, I was young enough that it wasn't like it was real. I don't remember it I remember it being scary and all that. Are kind of overwhelming, but I don't remember it being really traumatic or anything like that. It's not something that I thought about a lot as I grew up, I had this trauma, I just kind of put it out of my mind, which I think is kind of a kid's reaction often. I didn't really understand it, so I just sort of stopped thinking about it, maybe. I don't know. Anyway, I hadn't thought about it in years as an adult, but I will say that as an adult, what happened, and this was sort of the trigger for the book, is that once I had kids, I started having this dream every now and then, and the dream was always that I was walking through this fire, and there were these little bits of fire everywhere, these puddles of fire, and in the dream I was always looking for my kids. It was like, one of my kids is in this fire, I have to find them. And it wasn't a nightmare, really, but I remember sometimes waking up and thinking, oh, it's like I've been to hell, it's like I was walking around in hell or something, what is this? And so I had this dream once, and you know how sometimes you're having a dream and then the dream starts talking to you? So I'm having this dream and the dream is saying, you're the one in the fire. So it's a big message. And so I woke up and I went, oh yeah, I was the one in the fire. Like I was the kid who got lost in the fire. And so I got up. And I was going to write, I was working on something different at the time. But I got up, and just off the top of my head, I wrote out the scene of me being in the drugstore. Because it kind of came back in a flash, oh, I was almost in that drugstore. And so I wrote out the scene as if I was in the drugstore. And so that's the prologue in the book. And I wrote that out pretty much verbatim of how it is in the book. I mean, I made some, I did revise it, but I didn't make any huge changes after I wrote it. And I wrote it in kind of a burst of imagery. I had the images in my head, so I just wrote it all. And, I wrote it in an hour or something. And it's certainly in just a short morning. And then I put it away. And because I didn't know I didn't know if I was going to do anything with it. I couldn't think, it didn't occur to me that it could be a novel or that, I didn't know what it was. And then I didn't think about it really. I just kind of put it aside, didn't really look at it for about 6 months or maybe even closer to a year. And then I happened to be at my parents', I was helping them go through stuff in the attic, and I came across this box that had all this stuff in it from when I was a kid, and it was all my stuff. And it had this little journal, it was like my first little diary, So I'm opening that up and reading it, and all the page entries are really short. I have these entries we got a puppy, And it's 3 pages later, they're completely blank where I wrote nothing in it. And then it would be I went to the pool today. So I'm reading these. I was not real a real big writer or anything in that age, I guess. And then all of a sudden, I come to this entry for the date when this fire had occurred. And it's I've got 6 pages, my bad handwriting that I filled. And then what was interesting to me was then the next day after that, what I did in my diary is I wrote out this list of questions that I had about that fire. And it was this interesting list of questions to me because I realized reading it as an adult that I still have those same questions. You know, like one of them was, why would somebody do this? You know, it's a question that you would still ask as an adult, like, oh, well, I still have no clue why someone would do that. And how does something like, you know, like, why does that happen? And how come I didn't walk in that store? And how come so-and-so did walk in the store? And so I had these questions. And, you know, as I was trying to say last night, like, often I'm motivated in my writing by questions. So I started then to write more. All of a sudden, what I could see then, it just kind of came to me like a flash. I could see that there would be these four characters, and that they would be, you know, kind of circling this fire, and that they would, and that somehow or another, my questions would be, you know, that I still had would be generating this action, and so the book came out of initially those questions, and in particular, in as I say, one of those questions was like, who would do this? So I kept in the real story. So I went back and I talked to my mom, you know, my parents, and they said, oh yeah, the guy who blew up the drugstore, he ended up getting killed in the fire. That was the real story. But I decided, well, I was going to leave him alive so that I could answer my question, right? I was going to get to the bottom of this guy. That's my idea. And I wrote the whole first 125 pages probably. Pretty quickly, I want to say for me, pretty quickly, like in a few months, I wrote that. And then I had the major pieces in place of all that. And a lot of the stuff kind of came to me really kind of in a flash after reading those questions. Like I could see Elizabeth, and I knew that she was going to make this. I guess I'm really fascinated with hobbies and the way in which a hobby can become an obsession. And so I don't know if that's why that came to me that way, but the building of that mosaic on the wall, how that kind of gets out of control, that was something that that I saw sort of immediately with her. The character of the policeman was probably the most problematic initially, because, you know, anytime I think you have a type, you know, you want to, it's hard to make them individual, you know, so it's not, don't become a caricature or stereotype at all. So I think maybe initially I remember he was a little bit evasive. But at any rate, I wrote these first 125 pages pretty quickly. And the thing that generated it, I think, for me and made it easy for me to write is that I had this, they were all moving around the fire, you know, so I had the fire in the center. And then all these characters are circling the fire. And to me, the energy of that felt sort of like this vortex or spiral. And I could just, it just gave me a lot of momentum. So then I got to the end of that. And I was talking to my agent at the time. And she said, oh, yeah, send it to me. You know, even though it's not finished, send it to me. So I send it to her. And we have this conversation afterwards, and the first thing she says to me is like, she says, wow, this is really good. I really, really great material. She goes, but what are you going to do now? And I was kind of like, yeah, what am I going to do now? So like, that's the place where I got really stuck, because I didn't have something that was a center anymore. And I had these multiple points of view. So I had these four different points of view. So I needed something to be the center of this story to keep moving it forward, if that makes any sense. At least that's how it felt to me. And I didn't know what that was. And so, you know, I sometimes call that like the whole middle of the book, the soggy middle. But like, I was like caught in that for a long time, and I couldn't figure out how to generate the plot or where it ought to be going. And I had this George, and I knew it had Fowler, I knew it had something to do with him, and so it was just a lot of starts and stops and a lot of dead scenes. And so sometimes I'd write a scene and then I'd go back and look at it, and it wouldn't be alive at all. So when that happens with me, often I know that I've got the wrong thing. Like I have to rethink the event, or I have to rethink where it's going, or where I'm trying to go with it. So that was one of the hard parts. Another hard part was that I So when I finished it, then when I got a draft of it, I gave it to my agent, and I went down, and we had this conversation. And she had read it, and one of the first things she says to me, oh, yeah, it's all really great, and it's not quite ready to be sent out, but almost. And she goes, you know what? The church needs to explode. The church needs to blow up. And I said, well, really? And yeah, that was my response, really? And so she says, yeah, it needs to, you know, there needs to be this, that needs to be the climax. You know, you've got it set up. This is perfect opportunity. You need to blow up the church. So she's a really good reader, and I love my agent. I'd had her for a long time. So I thought, okay, I'm going to go work on this. I'm gonna blow up this church. And so, or George Power was going to. So, and of course, I didn't want to do it for every reason you're thinking. I didn't want to do it because, like, oh my God, really? It would be totally melodramatic and too expect. But anyway, I went home and I wrote this. I spent a long time on this. And I will say that I think that scene of when I blew up that church, when I finally got that scene, I think it's one of the best scenes I've ever written in my whole life. It was just so great when I got it. And it was the way in which the minister went inside and found this officer and the imagery and the, oh, it just was so powerful. And yet, so anyway, it was in there. And yet what ended up happening, of course, is that I realized that I couldn't blow up the church. And that it didn't fit with something that George Fowler would do, with what my character would do. Because that he would, that was not something he was interested, because I hadn't really understood my main character, my character, my killer. Because that's a question I started with, right? Why is somebody, who would do this? So I still didn't know who he was, is what I realized. And the more I got to know him, the more I realized that what he wanted was some sort of easy redemption and not to go blow up something else. And so that's why I couldn't use it, even though I liked the scene, I had to take it out. And the other thing that was hard, so two other things that I'll share with you that were hard. And one is that I really struggled with those scenes in which that George Fowler's in, where he's with the minister. Like, I rewrote that dialogue over and over again, because again, I was having trouble with that character. And initially, that character had actual chapters, like that character had a bigger voice in the book. And even up at the last minute, this was like sort of right before it was sort of going into some final edits and all of that had been taken and by a publisher, I just wasn't comfortable with the way I, with that character. And I just kept thinking, I don't really understand this character. And you know, like agents and stuff will say to you things like, well, at least mine do, it was say like, they're into psychology, sort of like, oh, why would he do that? Like, it's not clear, like the motives aren't clear. So I was trying to get, oh, what are his motives? I still didn't know what his motives were. So I was sort of in my mind just sort of driving myself crazy with all these questions. And then the neat thing was, is I was on the train ride going back from Ender. So I had been here for a residency, right? And so, I don't know, there's something about being, you're all thinking about, you know how it is after the residency and your brain's kind of buzzing and you're thinking about all this stuff. And so I'm riding back on the train and my brain was really going and I'm thinking, all of a sudden I thought, wow, I just had this real breakthrough. Like, the thing was, I wasn't supposed to understand this character. Like, this was the character who was supposed to be elusive. Like, that's reality, right? And in my mind, all of a sudden I realized, like, you can't know somebody like that who would do something like blow up a store and kill a lot of people, which he did kill a lot of people. So I reflected, I mean, and one of the things I thought of when I was thinking of all this was, you know, story or you know, different novels or stories where this had happened, and including like Flannery O'Connor's famous story, you know, A Good Man is Hard to Find, with the misfit, and how, like, there's the misfit, and you know, you really don't. She doesn't explain him at all. We don't know what his motives are. You know. Anyway, I related to that my killer had to be elusive. In the same way. So that what I ended up doing then was, that's how I got all those little, there's a lot of little elliptical passages that are just italicized about the killer. And so that's the only voice that you get of his. And so I intentionally made him, I realized that he was not somebody who could be and should or should be explained at all. And so I was happier with that. And then the other thing that was hard was, predictably maybe, is Sandy's, when she puts her hand on the door. And I think it's partly because that was my experience. You know, I always say this to students who are writing, I've always said this to students who are writing, if they're writing from something that's actually true, happened, I always say change something really big, change something, at least one thing. But if you only change one thing, have to be something substantial, something that matters. Because otherwise, then I think it's too easy to get stuck inside of trying to be true to something, and then your imagination doesn't enter into play. So I changed a lot of things, you know, I changed with Sandy. I didn't want her to be too close to me, so I gave her a very different personality than mine, and I made her, a little older. But still, that scene, which is something I had experienced and hadn't understood, was very hard to write about. So that's another scene that I rewrote over and over again. It was really hard for me to get the language and the action right, and et cetera. I did a lot of research while I was working on it. I tend to research everything. I read Martin Luther King's sermons, which were wonderful. They're beautifully written. I recommend them. I figured that my minister would have read some of those, so I read them. And I initially, in a draft, up until towards the end, I had some lines from his sermons in there. And I can't remember why those were taken out now. I think it might have been the rights or something. Anyway, I ended up taking those out. But there's still, the influence is still there, because he has this amazing passage about evil in one of his sermons, and in which he says, it just really startled me. He has this, it's a couple of paragraphs. I can't remember the exact quote, but it's kind of along the lines of, evil's real, which is something I never believed. You know, I didn't believe evil was real until I read that, and it really made me think about it. And it's kind of like, you know, have no question about it. You know, if you have a question about that, you're really naive. It's out there, it's real, recognize it. And if you don't, you know, you're not, it's kind of like you weren't accepting responsibility or seeing clearly. And so I think that had a real influence on how I saw George Fowler, and how the minister, what the minister was grappling with. The other things I used for research, I used the collection of Life magazines from that period. It was partly how I decided on the weeks, and so I wanted placed it after just after those riots occurred in Detroit and Newark, and there were lots of great pictures of those. I recommend the Life magazines if you can get them. I mean, Mount Holyoke was wonderful because they had them bound, and I could sit and actually look at the magazines rather than microfiche or something. But the other thing that you'll get if you look at the magazines is you're going to get the products people were using then, and the types of cars that they were driving, and all of that stuff. So that's really useful. Let's see, what other kind of research did I do? Oh, I did a lot of small town research, small town drugstores. And the other thing that I did was I did this online, and you would be amazed how much you can find. I had to research explosives, right? So how does one build a bomb? And it's amazing. You can find it all out online. Well, I know. Well, it's funny because my husband came home one night and I said, this is really incredible. You would not believe. You can go online and find out how to build all these bombs, these types of bombs. I've been doing this all day, you know? And he's like, oh, yeah, oh, great. Are you telling me, you know, FBI is going to be at our door tomorrow or something? But nothing ever happened because of it. I guess they didn't catch me. But yeah, I researched that. So I guess I'll just talk a little bit about the publication, and then I'll see if you have any questions. How are we doing for time? So this was a really, this book went through a lot of strange detours, some of which some of you know. I think Michael knows some of them. So I had this agent. I had two different agents and two different editors during the course of trying to publish this book. And I had this agent that I had had for all of my books. I'd had her for a long time. I'd had her since Patchwork, and I do still really love her. She's this wonderful woman. She's an incredible reader, a great agent. But what was happening was that there were a lot of things, a few things. One, I think she told me this. She had kept me with the same editor for the first three books, which probably was not wise, especially because this editor increasingly was not doing anything with books to, you know, make sure that they, it wasn't just me, I guess it was other authors, to make sure that they got sales, or she wasn't getting behind the books. So there was that. And then the other thing was is that she was very less available, or less, it wasn't sending out stuff as much. And she wasn't, and it wasn't me, just me, it was her, she was struggling. I think she was getting close, you know, feeling like maybe she wanted to retire. And then I didn't know about this at the time, I found out about it later, but she had this huge personal thing that happened. And so I had just finished this novel, and she was not in a position to be able to do anything with it. And so I was just gonna wait on all that. So I hadn't thought about leaving it. And then I happened to communicate with somebody who's a really well-known author and who is with William Morris, which is a really big agency. And she said, let me see the novel. So I emailed it to her. And then I mailed it to her. And then she contacted me and said, I love this, blah, blah, blah. I really want my agent to see it. But you have to be ready to switch agents if I show it to him. So it was really kind of a hard thing. I don't know if I made right decisions, but I'm not great with the, you know, I found that hard, the whole figuring out that end of the career, you know, the agent, editor, marketing, all that. I think it's a hard landscape to navigate for anyone, because it's changing so much and it's, you know, hard to know how to make decisions. But at any rate, I had a discussion with her on the phone, a couple of them, and she convinced me that what I needed was, she said, what you need is you need somebody who's well-positioned. And you need somebody who's going to really do something, because, you know, not enough has happened with your earlier books. All right, so I decided I would do that, and I switched over this agent, other agent. She was great in a way. She had me do some revisions of the book, which worked with me closely on that, which I do think this is a benefit. I think if an agent will do that with you, I think because, you know, it used to be that editors did that kind of work. They don't anymore, so more agents are. And so that was very helpful. And then she did send it out a lot. I'm not sure about the, I kind of got the sense that it was a little bit, I don't know if this is typical of bigger agencies, but it was sort of a little bit, she had tons of contacts, but maybe they weren't, it wasn't as carefully being placed, because my old agent would just do it one at a time, and she kind of did it in bigger groups. But at any rate, she did eventually sell it, right? Okay, so she sold it to this editor, found an editor who wanted it, to acquire it. And this editor was with Broadway, which is a division of Random House. And I had been with William Morrow, HarperCollins before. So it was a new publisher for me and a new editor. And I liked the editor a lot. And she was new to that position, but she'd been in editing for years. And I could tell she was really smart and she really got my book. So I was all excited. And so I worked with her on that book. You know how, like, so then when the editor took it, she wanted, this is as typical, I think, she wanted me to make a bunch of changes. So this, there was this like 9 month period where I'm making, working on revisions. And one of the things that she really wanted, and this other person who had sent me to William Morris had said the same thing, well, I'm not sure about the ending. So she wanted me to do this ending where she thought that everything had to be concluded. That's the only way I can describe it. And so she wanted me to write, we talked a lot about it, and was like, okay, I'll write an epilogue, you know, 20, 30 years later, and it will show how everything works out. And so I had kind of mixed feelings about that, but I wrote it. And I spent a long time on it, it was long. And I made some other changes to the end in addition. And I have it, the minister's giving his last sermon, and Sandy goes back to see it, and there's a scene between them, and so you get a sense of how things have been resolved. She wanted everything resolved, sort of that sort of ending. Oh, and the other thing was, she felt very strongly about this. We have to see that Elizabeth and Jack get married. And so I was kind of like, when she first said that, I was like, you do? And I, because I thought, well, maybe they wouldn't, but I don't know. But anyway, all right, so I wrote that. And I actually really ended up really liking a lot of that. I have this scene between the two of them, and they're older. And so I'd finished all that, and the book was ready to, I don't know, there was a meeting on the book and the final stages of things. And in the morning of that meeting, it was, I guess it happened at 8 o'clock, the editor later told me this whole story. They came in and they fired all of the fiction editors in one fell swoop. And she was the second. I forget what you call it, editor in chief or whatever of that division. So she and then the person right above her and then all of the fiction editors under them were let go. And they had to just be out of there. Like they had to pick up, get their stuff together and leave. Mm-hmm. And then they dropped all the books, including mine. So they just dropped them. I guess, and I don't understand quite, anyway, they were able to do it legally, as it turned out. So, my agent, I didn't feel like my agent handled that real great, like in terms of how she communicated with me about it. But she did eventually communicate with me about it. I had a hard time reaching her at first. She said that what she told me is, she kind of conveyed to me that now my book was like a hot potato that nobody would want to touch, even though it had been dropped for reasons that had nothing to do with the book. So I was kind of like, okay. And so she said, well, show me your next novel. That was her take on it eventually. And so I, meanwhile, the editor who I'd been working with contacted me, and she had gone back to her old job, or job she had once had, and she was editor-in-chief, acquiring editor at Women's Day. What's the other one that's connected to Women's Day? Ladies Home Journal. And so, so unfortunately, what that meant for me is that she wasn't going to another house. Because she was saying, oh, if I was going to another house, I'd take the book. But she couldn't. So she said, oh, that's outrageous that she won't show. She's not even going to try to do anything with that book. And so she's emailing me all this. Eventually, she calls me. She was upset about it. And then she said, this book is done. It was, you know, it needs to come out. Just send it to some small presses. And so she kept on me about that. I probably wouldn't have done it if she hadn't kept saying that to me. But anyway, that's why I sent it out myself to some small presses. My agent, I asked my agent, and she never even responded in an email. I said, you know, you want to send it to some smaller presses to me? And she didn't email me back. So, I'm going to be trying to get a new agent. I don't know if I can. I think I'll go for one that's a smaller agency this time. And that's kind of the other thing that Lorraine, who's the editor, said to me. In one of her emails, she said, you know, just a little bit of advice. I think you might be better off not having a big agent. You know, like yeah, if you're really famous, it's great to have a big agency, but maybe I was getting a little lost in all that. So anyway, yeah, I only sent it out to a few places, I think three places, because it was hard work. I didn't have time to, you have to write a letter, and I don't know. I just didn't have time to send it out that much. And I think I also wasn't sure how that would work or if it would work. But I'll say that she was right. And this, I just want to give this to you as, like, so you can remember this if you need it at some point, that if the book is good and the book is ready, it'll find a place. Like, she told me that, and I was like, oh, sure. But she was right. Like, you know, this press took it, and one of the places was a contest. It's, I think it's called DZANC or something. Docs, have you heard of that? It's mid-career writers, fiction novelists prize. So you have to have written, I think you have to have written three or four, maybe it's four books in order to apply for it. So I'd sent it into that. It has to be one that's not published that you send in. So I'd sent it in for that. And I was a finalist for that. And there were a lot of, like, really, you know, really great, I mean, some names I recognized on the list with. So I don't know, I felt good about it. And then they contacted me and said, help you find a publisher. You know, we can probably help you find a publisher if you need for it. But I had already heard from this place, University of West Virginia. And I can't remember why I sent it to them. I think somebody, I did use Duotrope a little bit, but quite frankly, I didn't have that much time. And I think I found one place on that, another press. And coincidentally, right after I took this, I emailed them and said, you know, I've already signed on with a small press. And they said, oh, we were just about to send you a letter saying we wanted to acquire it. So, I don't know. I guess that I guess that's just a long story to say that that it was confirmation that what this editor Lorraine had been telling me was true. And it was, and I was kind of feeling really jaded, I think, about the whole book industry. So it made me feel good that there are legitimate avenues out there for all of us. And that, you know, when your book's ready, you'll be able to find a place for it. The other thing I'll say about this is that it was very different working with these two different editors. So then, here I am at this house that is, you know, by their own description of what are they, what is this house? Oh, they're very... They're literary. They're more interested in publishing something that's literary. So, you know, I'm not quite clear what they mean by that. Everybody seems to have their own definition. But anyway, I start talking to this editor. Oh, first of all, what was different about the small press, I don't know if this is the same for all of them, but I have a couple other writers that I know are publishing with small presses, and it's the same for them. So it might be common. So I'll mention it might be helpful to know this. The way in which the small press worked that was different than what I was used to is when I was with the major houses, all the feedback comes from this one editor, right? Well, at the small house, it was the main editor who gives you her feedback, but then they give it to some readers, outside readers. And this is through the University of West Virginia, and they have a pretty big MFA program, I think, there. So they have an MFA program. And so I think it went to a couple of the faculty on there. So anyway, I got these long letters from them, you know, like four-page single-spaced letters of feedback. And I'd never experienced that before. So now I've got like three different things. And then I had to, my job was, and I only had like 2 days to do this or something, I had to take all three of those things and respond to what I was going to do with them and which things I was going to change and which things I wasn't in terms of a revision. And one of the letters was just pretty much this woman just, you know, person just wrote everything was great and, you know, and why, and there were this little thing she wanted me to change. But then the other letter had all this stuff, you know, so I had to really think about it. So that was kind of interesting to get all this feedback. And then the other thing that was really interesting was, so I'm talking to the editor about it after getting all this feedback, and she's like, this ending has got to go. You know, like, okay, like, I mean, why, you know, what is this? Jack and Elizabeth are getting married, you know, it's just so funny because she was like the exact opposite. And in the middle of this, where I'm like taking all this feedback going, yeah, yeah, well, I can get rid of this. I get this email from my first editor, Lorraine, who I'm still emailing back and forth with. And she's so happy that I found this publisher, and she's saying, you know, I'll do whatever I can, Ladies Home Journal, which she did. She was great. And Women's Day, you know, I'll support the book, you know, I'll whatever I can do. And you have to keep me informed. I can't wait to see what you do with it. And then she emails me the subject line, P.S. You know, I read the, whatever you do, don't drop that ending. Don't change a word of that ending, you know. And so it's like hard. So anyway, I ended up with the ending that the other press, that was the other press. The other thing that was kind of a nice surprise is that the, I you know, you have all these different copy editors. I really appreciate a good copy editor. And I had the best copy editor through the small press. And you know what? It was a graduate student who was doing an internship, and she's gone on to be an editor. I still get emails from her, and she was fabulous. And not just on the line of the, because I even appreciate a good copy editor just for talking about syntax and punctuation and somebody who understands style. But she was great in terms of compression of the language. If any place wasn't quite clear for a reason or a word choice was slightly off, she had tons of stuff. She did so much work on that book, and she was so great to work with. And the editing process was really quick because they acquired the book in January, was when I had to write those letters. And then I had to be done with all the edits by May, beginning of May. So usually, I think typically it's more like a year, but this was like 6 months. So I don't know if I have anything else that I've got down here. Do you have any questions you want to ask me? Yes.
The mosaic reminded me of Homer Hickam's mother's mural.
Oh, I haven't read that.
They're living in the coal mines. His father's a supervisor, and his mother's escape from it all is this beautiful mural of Myrtle Beach, where they have their honeymoon that she keeps working on. And at one point, the strikers shoot out the window, and it puts a hole in the mural.
Oh, neat.
But I thought the scene where the broken officer goes to the broken woman with the broken dishes to bring the wedding ring, and then the child cuts her foot, and he takes care of the foot, and she's upset about the glass, and he says, he'll sweep it. Yeah. So I thought that was the most beautiful scene, because it had all the elements of brokenness and healing, and this voice of confidence that things will get better.
Oh, thank you. Well, you know, and I was saying this in my workshop this time, because everybody in there had these sort of complicated plots and points of view and stuff. But a lot of people working on novels that had a few different storylines. But I think if you have a few different storylines or a few different points of view in your book, you know, one of the things you need to do is increasingly those lines need to cross. You need to find ways for them to intersect. And you can find this in any book that does that well. Examine it. It's interesting. You'll find the places where they cross are often, you know, have the potential for this great dramatic energy. And so that was one of my first early attempts to make those storylines cross in some sort of a meaningful way in these two characters who hadn't known each other. And the mosaic thing, I think that partly come, I have a sister who's an artist. She's an art therapist, but also an artist. And she works a lot with, she does work with mosaics. And, you know, on a much smaller level, like, you know, doing like small pieces around fireplaces or something like that. So that was like, I think, you know, where that image came from. And then again, the idea of has always really appealed to me. of somebody who has a hobby that, and then it becomes an obsession. Yeah.
Was the drugstore ever rebuilt, like down the line?
Not as a drugstore.
It wasn't built, so even though they, yeah, they kind of said they didn't have the funding to rebuild it, so what would it end up becoming? Did you ever go see what it became, or was it like a little bit weird for you?
I didn't go back. After we didn't live there very long, and I don't know if I went back. We lived there a few years. For a long time, it didn't. I think it might have been even up to 10 years. It really was nothing. They didn't build anything there. And you know, that's a good question. What is it now? I resisted going back. I thought about, because I was kind of traveling near there at one point, and I thought, oh, I should just drive back past Circle through, you know, through this place. But I didn't, because. I don't know. There was something that kind of, I just felt like it might mess me up or something. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Because I had the town in my imagination, you know. Yeah, Mary?
I wonder if the writing of the novel gave you any kind of personal resolution to the conflict you experienced early on. Did you have the dream again?
No, it's funny, I have. No, I have not had the dream. So maybe. I never really thought about it, if I got a resolution. I mean, I just realized, like I was saying the other night, your questions never can be answered. Well, that was one of mine. I was kind of mad that when I first realized that I'm not going to be able to answer this question. But I think that ultimately, there must be some sort of resolution, even though I didn't ever feel like I had understood it really any better or much better.
And yeah, I was wondering if you talk about scenes where the reverend is kind of counseling George, or maybe not counseling George. Yeah. I think the dialogue is so interesting in those scenes, because especially when they're talking about God, and then you break it off and George asks, like, you know what it takes to build a bomb, and then he starts singing it, and there's so many different levels to that dialogue, and I wondered about your experience in writing those two characters in the office.
Well, it was hard. I mean, I rewrote those sections a lot. I think that it took me a long time to get both of those characters and what they would say. Minister was hard too, because you know, I didn't want him to be too predictable. And there was that whole question of would the minister like turn him in right away or whatever. I went back and forth in my mind on that. But what I did with that dialogue, I know that made a difference for me, was I sometimes do this. I split it up into monologues. So I wrote them each out as their monologues. And because that allows you, in a dialogue like that, where the two voices are really, really different, You have to do a few things, right? You have to have these two very different voices that might be on the same page, or in that case, their case, weren't on the same page a lot of the time. And then the other thing that you have to have is you have to have the conflict that somehow or another is playing out between them. And these were two characters. I think the reason I did it, I'm just trying to think, why did I do it that way? But I think the reason I did it that way was probably because that was an instance where these were two characters who weren't always communicating with each other. So it wasn't like, you know, they were hearing one another and then responding. So I think it was useful for me to really get to hear their voices, to sort of write them out as a rant, and then write the other one out, and then try to put it together and work out the responses, so that there are places in the dialogue where the two of them are kind of going at it head on with each other. But then, like you said, there are these other places where George just says something sort of out of left field that doesn't relate to what the minister has said. Yeah. Yeah, thanks for asking about that scene, though, because those scenes were hard. Those were hard scenes to write. Yeah.
When all this happened with the editors and the publishing and all that, did you at any point just give up on the book?
You mean give up on trying to publish it, or what do you mean?
Yeah, just
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. Did I give up? I can't remember. I think I've wiped it from my memory. fortunately, I don't remember that. It's hard to do that.
Yeah.
You're right. And, you know, of course, it was devastating to get that news. I think it really helped me. I think it always helps to have people that you're talking to about it. It really helped me to talk to the editor, because she was like, yeah, I think about her. I mean, they just all got fired right off the, you know, out of nowhere. And so it kind of put it in perspective for me that mine was just one book. This was their life, you know. And then it was so that was the first conversation I had with her that sort of like put it in perspective, getting the story from her. And then she was very generous in, you know, communicating with me and wanting to kind of keep, she kept pushing, you know, she would just email me again and say, have you done anything yet with it? And so I think that helped me a lot, was to have somebody, because I could sense in her emails and in her, when she called me, the couple times she called me, how much she believed in it. And I think that made it a little more possible for me to believe it. But yeah, when I sent it out myself to those small presses, I thought, nobody's going to come over this. I really didn't think anything would. I think that's probably why I only sent out to a few places, because I didn't expect it to go anywhere. I was kind of just doing it because she thought I should.
I'll just sort of comment or compare your experience with mine and answer to this question.
Yeah.
My first novel, I revised it a number of times since my agent. We tried to auction it, didn't go in the auction, and finally Random House bought it. And the editor there, like your situation, really liked it. And then she took a job as a senior editor at HarperCollins. So she tried to bring the book. Well, it just at that time, HarperCollins was cutting 150 titles.
Oh boy.
And she needed to cut down. And I came into that, you know, that vortex, and I was one of those. So for 3 years, and Random House didn't want to publish the book because there was nobody there who was a supporter of it, okay, who was going to be the person ushering. If you have a fatherless, you know, book at a place, it spells a death knell. So for 3 years, it just sat there. I went on to write my next book.
Yeah.
And in the meantime, I got myself a lawyer, and the lawyer looked at all, this is back in the early days of email, but mostly was paper trail. He said, give me the paper trail. So I sent him all the paper trail. My argument was, it's going to hurt my career. They had promised, they had already paid me, blah, blah, blah. And he sent a letter to HarperCollins. A week later, we said, your book will be out in October. and I knew that they were going to just publish it and then wash their hands. And so I then did all sorts of stuff, and I really got behind it. I read interviews of people who published, self-published their books, or published in a small press, or even published in a large press. And I, for the year, I did everything imaginable, and that book went into 8 editions, and first in hardback, and 3 editions in paperback. It won all sorts of awards,
wow.
And then suddenly they wanted me for the next book, and they gave me 2 book contracts. But that was the first thing.
Yeah.
I was, for 3 years, I was in a funk. But I had to move on and write the next book. Okay, and sometimes it happens, and it's happened with short stories of mine. It had, you know.
Yeah.
I thought it was the only author this ever happened to. And you find out it's very common, and what you have to do is you have to go on to the next book. Okay? You have to make sure that first book is good. And at some point, if nothing ever happened to it, I knew that first book was good. I would have sent it somewhere else on my own. I would have done exactly what you did.
Yeah. I mean, you know, I think that in some ways, small press was just as, yeah, because nowadays, you know, a lot of these bigger presses, this is where Lorraine was telling me this, and I think this is probably true, a lot of the bigger presses aren't doing that much publicity. You know, you're not getting as much marketing or publicity as you used to get. I mean, my first two books, especially my second book, they sent me all over the country on tour. I mean, they don't do that anymore, you know? And I remember it didn't happen with my third book, and that was where my editor didn't get behind it at all. And then, you know, the sales were not, I mean, it did come out in paperback and everything, and it got some very good reviews, but the sales weren't great. And so, you know, I think that the small press, what I was impressed with is that they really did, and I was talking to Al about this actually this morning because he was saying his press does the same thing. They really did a good job of sending it out to get reviewed, like to a lot of places. They didn't kind of keep on them as much as they could have. I was in a very good position about with this because I, in terms of publicity, because I have, there's a woman that I went to college with, and she was an English major. Well, she became a publicist, and she worked. She's done a lot of things, but she was for a while. She was with one of the bigger publishing houses as a publicist, and she got kind of sick of how they were doing things. So she went out on her own, and she's able to just freelance. But she's had all these really big clients. Like, she was the main publicist for a number of years. She got tired of doing that too, I think, for the Bezos family, which, you know, they own Amazon. And so she is really good, and she you know, she's just so nice, and she loves my books. And she was like, you know, she wouldn't even. I mean, I took her. It's like ridiculous. I took her out to dinner a few times. I mean, she wouldn't let me give her any money for it. She just did all this extra work. So she sent out for me also, so that the publicist at the small house, the thing that was good about it was that this was a young woman, and she was, instead of being territorial about it, which my friend was afraid she might run into, she said, yeah, I don't know how much I'll be able to use, sometimes publicists are territorial. This woman was not at all. She was like, she was new to it. She was like, oh, I really want to learn from you. So they would do things like split lists. And anyway, I think the book got sent out to a few more newspapers and stuff that way. She sent it out to some awards, and I did get that independent publishing award for fiction that year, which was great. And that resulted in, I forgot to bring the stickers with me, but anyway, there are all these stickers that supposedly, they don't seem to be putting them on the books. They're supposed to be putting the stickers on the books. Oh, you've got one, yeah. Yeah, so they put these little gold stickers on, that's supposed to help sales. But I went to, I did a lot of readings. I was in Virginia as a writer in residence. Right after it came out. So I also did a lot of readings in the South and in that kind of Midwest area, and I did some at universities. Universities and colleges are very good places to read because you have often get a bigger audience than you would in a bookstore. And I did Virginia Festival of the Book, which is a really great book festival. And they put you on a panel. You have to apply for it, so you have to send your book in and apply. And then and it's really fun too. There's all these writers and you're on a panel, and then people buy your book after that. And then what was great about that was that through that Virginia Festival of the Book, somebody who a writer down there who works with one of the bookstores who runs a big book group. It's a large book group, like, I don't know, 40 people or something, and she read my book. And then contacted me and said if she used it with her book group, would I talk with them? Which of course I would. So then that was a great opportunity that I think it was like I did the panel one day, and then the next day I did that book group. So yeah, I tried to do everything I could. You do have to. You know, I think, especially now, you really have to, a lot of this comes down to maybe with the bigger houses too, but certainly with a small house, you they were very willing to help me with the logistics, getting the books there, helping to set up the readings, but I had to make the initial moves. So I had to say, oh, you know, I'm going to be so-and-so, wonder if there's a bookstore, could you email this bookstore, so I had to kind of take the initiative, and I've never had to do that before. I mean, always in the past, the publicist has just set it up, and they send you this schedule, and then you go do it, but I had to come up with my own events and my own schedules and stuff.
You're also having a panel on Sunday. Bill.
Yeah.
Memoir, novel, I think so. We'll wrote that on Sunday.
Well, that sounds good. So any other questions? All right. Well, thank you. You guys have a great audience for me.